supposedly not that they're not able to see those lights, so hopefully it won't have too much of an impact on them. And this female elephant, as you can see, she's on an absolute roll. She's been kicking over lots of small trees and digging out their roots, just like she was doing right now. And I'm sure that youngster, there he comes again, coming in to see if he can pick up mom's scraps. Mom was getting very upset with the little one a few moments ago. And hopefully, as mom is digging up all these roots, this youngster is taking notice of how a mom is doing it, how she's using her feet. It's quite amazing how she utilizes every part of her body. So a few minutes ago, there was a really, obviously quite a deep-rooted root, and she was struggling to pull it up with her trunk. So it was incredible. She went down onto her knees, her front legs, and she sort of locked her feet underneath it. Then she stood up and she stretched back onto her back legs and completely ripped the root straight out of the ground. I've never seen that technique before. It was quite amazing how she did that. They're happily munching away. So elephants do feed for about 19 hours a day. So I suspect when we do see them a little bit later, they are just going to be eating. They will normally rest during the hot hours of the day and keep moving at night. Go on, little one, go in and see if you can pick up some more of mom's roots that she's left behind. It's got a little twig of some sort. Maybe it's this very small root that it's munching on. And every now and then as well, this youngster tries to take a little suckle. But I think unfortunately, mom's milk is not as sweet as it used to be. Let's see what she's going to do now. Can see there how the back of her heel she's using almost like a spade, and she scoops the dirt into that indentation and it all comes out. Now, we've been seeing the elephants eating the roots, and I was telling you earlier a little bit about how elephants sort of eat the trees. Now, Tasha Michelle would like to know, do they just eat bits of the tree to get the bark or to get any nutrients, or are they just sort of crushing it and getting the liquid out of it? And now, yeah, a cr sort of a yes answer for both of them. It depends on if it's a new branch or if it's an old branch. A new branch is a lot softer and it's easier for them to sort of crunch away. And then what they may do is they may eat entire parts of it. If it's an older branch, then they're normally just stripping the bark to try and get to the cambium level. So outside that harder, rough bark, just on the inside of that, there's a layer called a cambium layer that has got quite a bit of nutrients, and that's the layer that the nutrients are indeed transported from the roots to the leaves. Now, in the winter months, there's no need to do this because there are no leaves on the tree, and that's when you see them putting the branches into their mouths and just sort of corkscrewing them around, and then they are just going for the cambium layer. But sometimes, like I said, if it's a young branch, they'll actually squash the entire thing and eat it whole. The other elephants have moved off completely out of sight. We just hear them rumbling every now and then, just communicating with each other. Now, elephant communication is quite amazing. They have four main ways that they communicate, and often we hear a trumpeting. Now, trumpeting isn't a good sign, everybody. Normally, it means that they are in distress. However, it could also mean that they are excited. And we were witnessing a little bit just while we were off camera, this youngster throwing a tantrum and was letting out a few trumpets, just very upset with mom. The other way that we sort of hear is the rumblings that seem to come from their stomachs, and it's sort of a, I'm going to try and imitate the rumbling, everybody. I don't know how good that was, but that is my impersonation of an elephant rumble, and that can travel quite a distance. So those rumblings sort of start in their stomachs, and I think they go right down into their feet, into the ground. And elephants have got sensory nerves in their feet that allows them to pick up those vibrations from many kilometers away. The rest of their communication is done through infrasound, which unfortunately is frequencies so low that we cannot hear them. She is on a digging spree, everybody. And I don't blame her, though. She might as well make the most of digging for roots. And then she'll be rewarded with lovely, fresh shoots of grass that are coming up in the moment. Now, when she's pulling up these roots, I don't know if you've seen, let's just watch quickly. When she pulls them up, and hopefully we'll see it, there's quite a bit of soil still left on the root. Now, normally what they'll do is they'll shake it slightly just to get rid of some of that soil. They often do that with grass when they pull the entire roots out of the ground. There we go. See, she's got a bit of a bulb there as well. They'll shake them a little bit, like she's doing there. See how she's moving it around in her trunk? She's trying to get rid of that soil. So Oakley has asked if the soil damages their teeth. Now, Oakley, that is indeed correct. To a point, it does wear it down to some extent. That is why they do spend a considerable amount of time, like we just witnessed now, of her rolling it around on her trunk, trying to get rid of some of that sand. And as I was saying, they do it with the grass too. They will wrap their trunks around some nice long pieces of grass, and then they will shake it and try and get all that soil that is clumped onto the edge of the roots and then eat it. But of course, they can't get all of it, to get rid of all of it, I'm afraid. So it does wear down their teeth a little bit. That's what we were chatting about earlier, is that their teeth tend to wear down a lot quicker during these winter months when the vegetation is scarce and they have to sort of dig for it beneath the ground. In the summer months where it's lovely, lush and green, it's not such a problem. Everybody, all the insects have just come alive. I'm going to sit very quiet for about a minute and just let you enjoy the wonderful sounds of nature while you watch these beautiful animals. Can you hear how everything has just come alive in the last few minutes? A lot of insects. Looks like I can hear some cicadas and crickets, and I can even hear the occasional frog squeaking away in the distance. And the birds that you are hearing are made up of crested Franklins and Natal spurfowls, and they're just giving their last call just before the sun sets this evening. So they're going to find some nice spots to roost and wait out the night until the sun rises again tomorrow. Well, the sun has just disappeared behind the horizon. We can't see it anymore. So I reckon in about 20 minutes or so, it's going to be a lot darker than it is now. And hopefully we're going to be able to switch over to the infrared. And I cannot wait to see what is going to be out there for us later this evening. I haven't done a night drive in a few months. So normally, like you see here, the game drives consist of usually about an hour of darkness, but not much after that. So it's going to be great to spend some time out in the African wilderness in the middle of the evening. Now you saw she pulled that branch up quite easily. That looks like a bit of sandpaper raisin that she ripped out of the ground. Now she's not really going to eat the branches that are coming off that. I think she's just going to chew on the roots. Of like a bunch of grapes, the way that they were all stuck together quite nicely. She didn't shake it though, so there's probably quite a bit of soil that she's eating now. you go. Last few roots in her mouth they go. Oh, how exciting, everybody. I believe that James has got his infrared up and running. Why don't you head on over to him and see how that looks?
There we are, everybody, our little lioness. We've moved round. Her eyes are open. She might look like she's looking at us, but well, in theory, all she should see is couple of fairly dim red glows. She is in infrared, and as far as I know, we're in black and white there. There, one of the males calling. She's going to call now. Let's see. One of the males was just calling. There we go. Interesting that she's doing most of the calling. Is responding, but not the one here. It's interesting. One here is just lying there, wondering where his tail went. See? Can't quite figure out why it is. That she feels like half a lion. Now, just to give you an idea, with my sort of naked eye, as it were, I can sort of make them out. Chandra, of course, has got a bright white light blinding me completely, but when I shield that from myself, I can just sort of make them out. These infrared lights are really quite special. And the thermal one is also pretty cool. And just in case you're wondering if there are leopards here, yes, we do see leopards here. We saw one leopard so far. We saw his back end sitting in a tree. He killed a wildebeest calf, I think. Oh, she's quite tired, but this, of course, as you know, is often a precursor to them getting up and moving or licking their feet. Those claws that unfortunately were used to destroy the life of a little wildebeest calf today, but everything has to eat. I think we should make a little turn around them, don't you, Jandre? We'll get her face, unless we just, let's wait here for a little while. We're not going to see anyone coming down the road. I'm going to ask Graham to perhaps stick the flare down the road to see if there isn't another male coming yet, but it doesn't seem there is. There is the flare monitor looking eerily Blair Witch style down the road. Oh, and there is the lioness, like an Egyptian god. Pale white upon the termite mound. Isn't that cool? That's called infrared and thermal imaging. That's what we do here. That's how we roll at Wild Earth. That's me in infrared, Jandre. That's dangerous. Don't do that to me again. That's so cool. Now, it's pitch black dark now here in Vamara. I think you've still got a bit of light left in South Africa, which is quite cool. And we're into now the second drive in a row, as it were. And I must just tell you that while we look at these sleeping kitties, This is the first time I've ever heard myself present a full show. I can hear my own voice talking to myself exactly 1/2 second after I say what I say. It is very disconcerting, and my brain may explode before 11 o'clock tonight. Chandra, we heard that. Was that your belly? Yeah. The other bad news, of course, is that we don't have our packed suppers with us, which means we're going to be very cranky at the end of this. Yes? Oh, there seems to be some heat there on the floor, everybody. I wonder if that ain't a herd of beefalo. Look at that. Seem to be a herd of buffalo heading this way. All right, while we try and figure out what exactly those white spots are in the background, Jamie Patterson is back with the 8 little Nkahuma cubbies.
We are back with them, and my word, what a noise everybody's making. Bless you, girl. Lion cubs everywhere. Lioness is desperately trying to gather them all together as night starts to fall. How cool is this? There is not one single light on around our vehicle. And whilst I can still see them, the time is going to come very shortly when I cannot. Lionesses are contact calling constantly. I think gathering their cubs together at this time of day is kind of like herding wet cats. As they try to gather them together, possibly even try and find a safe place to leave them before they head out into the night to see if they can catch something. Because the one thing that's very noticeable is that whilst the males have full bellies and the females do not, one small antelope is not enough to feed 5 adult lionesses, especially not. Oh, wow, yes, very scary. Amazing. And right next to us, can I look back into camera, Dave? I can look back into camera. Right next to us is a lioness in almost total darkness, gently cleaning her cub. How incredible is this? The vision, ladies and gentlemen, of Graham Wallington and his incredible team is slowly but surely coming to life. Not that it hasn't already, but as technology reaches the point where we can bring you these scenes, I don't think we could be any more excited than we currently are. Look at you. This is something we've not been able to see. We've never been able to stay with these cubs after dark. And as I said, if they do move, then I am not going to be following them. Oh, it sounded like you were talking there, little one. As the cubs have a little bit of an argument, let's jump all the way back to the Mara Triangle.
Link. Now we've moved slightly, everybody. This is the second male now. Got up and come across here, probably to see what's going on. He's exhausted after his walk of 150 meters. It's approximately 400 feet. He seems to be missing an ear, is he? Oh, I wonder. Maybe he's just got a scraggly I've just got up haircut. maturity. They are in prime conditions, these male lions. But they're not youngsters. You might be able to see they're just a bit fuller up. They're a bit fuller, I mean a bit filled out compared with the Birminghams. And it's now completely dark outside. And what we'll do at some stage, not right now, is just show you exactly how dark it is by turning off the IR. He is now grazing. This is because he feels like he might be a wildebeest. No, he's decided I'm not a wildebeest after all. But I do have a slightly sore tummy after all the wildebeest I've been eating. Now the reason there are so many hundreds and thousands of different animals living on these plains is because of many of the grasses that you're looking at now that this lion is luxuriating in. And most of it's called Themida triandra, or red grass. Here they call it red oat grass, which is a rather more romantic name, I feel. And it just supports an incredible array of animals because the soil beneath it is so much more fertile than it is in southern Africa. And that's because in southern Africa you've got those big woodlands, and those woodlands are supported by soils that are far less fertile than the ones here. And that's because the ones in South Africa are much more ancient than the ones up here. There's relatively, well, in fact, very distant volcanic activity in this area, but much more recent than it was in southern Africa. And so that's why these great plains contain so many nutrients that are able to sustain this immense sward of red grass, and in turn the herbivores that come and eat on it year in and year out. I think the other interesting thing about the system, while we watch this lion just licking his feet, is that it really is an area of, probably completely wilderness. You know, there's no human interference at all. There's no pumping of water, bar for one little pond that I saw that I think is more a borrow pit than it is pumped water. And also crucially, there's one sort of management regime of the land. Huge areas of land get burned every year and then they get rested, but because there's only one kind of landowner, it all gets treated in the same way, and I think that's a tremendously effective way to run a piece of wildlife land. Very nice. Just remember, we're as live as everyone else is, and we're going to be live. If you're surprised as to why we're still live, this is the safari marathon, if you like. We're going to be live for 7.5 hours, which means we do need to keep talking to you. Please, hashtag safari live, questions at wildearth.tv. And I know perhaps many of our British viewers are getting home from work or arriving home and thinking about cooking some fish and chips or mushy peas or some bangers, perhaps even. He is missing that ear, you know that. There we are. Is he? I think it's earless. Earless, pom-pomless, and a couple of others. They do have proper names if this is the male coalition we think they are, and I'll get to that a little bit later. So back to the British guests or British viewers. If you are watching, please, it'd be great to have some questions from you, of course, because this is now your time of having supper. While you think about what you're going to have, let's head across to Jamie, who has got still the Nkuhuma cubs in the last of the Southern African sunbite.
This is the weirdest and coolest feeling in the world. The lion is lying right in front of our vehicle. I can barely see her in the gathering darkness. I can just hear the noises coming from the front of the vehicle. And I'm effectively entirely reliant upon Dave to show me what's going on. This is so cool. Also, quite weird. Cub's having a tantrum, having a suckling tantrum. There they go, wandering into the drainage line. Two of the cubs have just Oh, my word, this noise. Pardon? How awesome. I don't think my eyes have ever been so wide. Struggling to see in the dark. Where did that third lioness one? Where did she disappear to? I've got no idea. This is such a strange feeling. It's amazing how incredibly brave the cubs are at night as well. One of them's right next to our vehicle, right near the front. These two over there have been having such an argument over that piece of skin on the right. They have been fussing and growling at each other, making noises that you wouldn't even believe possible coming out of something so small. The fiercest of growls, they sound like adult lions. And they've been having the fiercest tug of war. And they just refuse to give in. A battle of wills going on. Look at those ears on the one on the right. Right back, flat. This is so surreal. I can hear them moving all around me, but I can't see them properly. It really is the strangest feeling. And right now, we've just got to wait for them to move. Now, Tracy, you wanted to know, is it safe for us to be so close to the lions at night? And the answer is yes. It is. As we've said many times, when we're in the vehicle at night, we're not on their menu. When we're on foot at night, it's a totally different story. That being said, even though I know, rationally, I'm completely safe, and Dave is completely safe, there is still that part of us that is very, very primitive. And in the darkness, we're so aware, we're so robbed of our primary sense, that you can't help but kind of have your head on a swivel. Your hearing suddenly 10 times better than it was before, and I keep peering backwards as if I'm going to see something. So whilst yes, we are 100% safe, it is a very disconcerting feeling. It's a very, very strange feeling. Luckily, the cameraman and the presenters have been working together day after day, hour after hour, for an extended period of time. We always talk about presenter cameraman sync when we chat in our review sessions, and this is where it's become more important than ever before. Like now, when I just heard a lioness trip over a log and come next to the vehicle. Dave was there. Thank you, Dave. I wondered where she went. Oh, sorry, let me move my head. I can't begin to describe this feeling to you. It's both exhilarating and my heart's racing at the same time, which I suppose is exhilaration in its own way. It's like being on a roller coaster. This is so unbelievably cool. Amber Eyes has disappeared. I have no idea where she is. What an interesting observation from Bethany, who says it looks like the back stripe on the back of the ears of the Nkuhumas are horizontal and those on the back of the ears in Kenya are vertical. You wanted to know if they're different for each individual lion. They're definitely different for each individual lion, as our lioness disappears into the darkness. But at the same time, I'm sure there is a genetic combination there. So if there's, in this particular area, if the genetics have gone towards horizontal ear stripes, then that's what we're going to see. Whereas... Sorry, I'm just listening to the Game Drive channel as well. I'm sure there is a genetic link. And the lions in Kenya will look different to the lions in South Africa. Hello, look at you. With your bright eyes. Ah, oh, look at this. Hello. Gorgeous little faces. All the while we're watching these two cubs play, the other two, from what I can hear, I can't see, but I can hear, they are fiercely, still furiously fighting over that piece of skin, somewhere there, somewhere in that general black direction. There we go. Well done, Dave. Dave's job is now infinitely more complicated because he's got to do all kinds of things like positioning of the infrared lights, positioning of the camera. So a serious round of applause for our incredible cameraman who somehow managed to get better every single step that this company takes. A truce has been reached. They're just growling at each other now and holding the piece of skin. There's not even any meat on it. They've just got it in their mouths. Awesome. I can't see anything now. The light is dark enough, the sun has gone down enough, that I absolutely cannot see anything. Except the beeping of the VR in the front, or the flashing of the VR in the front that I can see. Oh, such fierce growls. And you can actually see how incredibly important that black on the back of the ears is. Oh, here we go, we've got some calling again. As our third lioness rejoins us once more. Largely silent because half of the magic of the sighting is the sounds that are coming from these lions. This is amazing. I've been listening keenly to the Game Drive channel at the same time, and some interesting things have been happening. Let's jump on board with Taylor and see if there's more that she can tell you.
Hello again, everybody. I just found us a big male leopard, but he has now disappeared into some very, very thick vegetation, I'm afraid. He's been quite vocal, so I'm just going to sit here patiently and hope that I can call again, just so he can pinpoint his location to us. It's one of the resident male leopards known as Tingana, and boy, is he a beautiful boy. But I can't see where he's gone now. It seems like he's come from the north and he's coming south. So I was really hoping that he was going to pop out just over here. And I'm waiting for Aubrey to also come and give us a hand. When these animals do move through the very thick vegetation, it makes it quite difficult to move along through here. Let's carry on a little bit. Perhaps he's on his way to the Juma Dam to have a look. I mean, to have a drink. So if you can, please keep an eye out on the dam cam for me in case he makes it there before I do. And I'm just going to jump on the radio just to try and find out where Aubrey is, because I really, really need his help. He's got a tracker, and his trackers, it helps a lot, because when maneuvering off-road, he's got someone to help him and tell him where to sort of drive. Aubrey Taylor. Aubrey, I don't have visual of this, my daughter Ingwe. I don't know if he's gone through the Chkovenin that runs just to the north of Vuyotela towards the Mati. I'm going to carry on with shortcut, Galago shortcut, and head towards the dam. Goodness, it's so difficult to multitask with all these things. Let's go around here. He didn't come out unless he's gone into the camp itself. I'm not sure. Okay, right, everybody. I think let's go to James and see what he's up to while I try and navigate through the drainage lines here on Juma and try and find Tingana.
Now, this is just a brief shot, everybody, of what you're looking at there. It's one lion in the foreground and a herd of beefaloes coming this way from the other side. Now, this, of course, is why we came here. Let's go down to the IR view of the actual lion. That's me. Hello. The lion is over there. And there he is, over the top of the schnorkel. And we're here, of course, to try and see if we can follow a lion hunt at night, and you can see that there is clear space between the buffalo and the lion. But these lions have been roaring, and so their enthusiasm for hunting, well, it must be called into question. But let's see what happens. This is a great opportunity to see if the lions of the Mara are going to hunt the buffalo across these plains. It would be quite something to see. We thought for a second there might be gnus, but no, they're not. They're definitely buffalo. They're too big. Sitting next to me, you may have seen there, is Simon. And Simon is the head warden at the Ulololo Gate, which is the major... Oh, this is exciting. I'll tell you a bit more about Simon later. Taylor has got the spotted prince of cats.
We just keep missing him, everybody. He's disappearing into the darkness, as you can see. I haven't switched to infrared just yet, everybody, just because it's proving difficult to try and keep up with him, and I really need to be able to see where I'm going. Let's try and get him again. He's playing cat and mouse this evening, but I'm so excited because it's the first time I'm able to see Tingana. And I know Jamie had such a special sighting of him the other day. Now, he's very vocal. He just called again, so hopefully we're going to be able to catch him calling for us, because it's quite a beautiful sound. It's not quite like a lion roar. There he is on the road again, and I just need to tell Aubrey that we've got him. Aubrey, we're still on shortcut, Galago shortcut. His little mobile east. There's one unlocked, Makula, my daughter Ingwe, one making their approach. He's gonna mark over here. Can you see that? See how he's spraying his urine up against this tree. Listen, listen. Can you all hear that? Now, this is Karula's territory, everybody. So I wonder if he's perhaps looking for her, or he could also be doing a territorial patrol with him marking his territory like that. He's maybe just indicating to everybody that, let me get out of four-wheel drive, otherwise we're not going to be able to go anywhere. Maybe he's just indicating to the other male leopards that this area is occupied. This is quite exciting. I'm going to be doing a lot of turning around and trying to focus on where I'm going. Oh no, please don't go into the thick bushes, Tingana. Until he settles down, I think we're going to stay with just a spotlight. And when he becomes a little more static, then we'll try and switch to IR. It's just very thick vegetation through here, everybody. But isn't he beautiful? He's a big leopard.
and I believe he's about 9 years old, and he doesn't even have a neck anymore. He's just got a dewlap. Can you see that? Look when he turns to the side there. Now that's an indication that he is well mature. Fantastic genetics. We're going to try and keep up with him. He's very relaxed with the vehicles, which is quite nice. Here he is, just going to come out to the left of us. Everyone, I just need to update the sighting. There are lots of people asking away here. Murdera Ingwe is still mobile along a shortcut, Gallagher shortcut. He's mobile in an easterly direction. I presume he's going to head to the Mati, to Puza. There's one on lock, one standing by, or I think two mobiles now standing by at the Mati. Right, everybody, let's carry on following this man. Isn't it incredible? I was uncertain if we were going to see a leopard this evening. We were actually stopping using the luxury facilities, and I got quite a fright, obviously. Basically, it got caught with my pants down and the leopard calling in the distance. Can you imagine how frightening that must have sounded? Quite funny, though. Oh, now he's walking straight down the middle of the road, everybody. When he goes to this dam, and if he, I'm thinking that's what he's going to do, he's heading straight there, then we will switch to infrared, because hopefully we'll get a few moments with him when he's not moving too much. It's just unfortunately going to be too difficult for me to try and navigate if he does decide to go down into one of these drainage lines. There he is. Oh my goodness, he's giving us a show this evening. Let's try to keep up with him again. Isn't that incredible? That raspy call that he does. That's quite spectacular. And hopefully we'll be able to try and follow him for quite a while this evening and see what he gets up to, seeing as we're going to be staying out nice and late this evening. So I hope you've all got your popcorn ready and a nice cup of tea or something along those lines, just to keep you going for the next few hours. Now, what are you going to do? Are you going to go left or are you going to go right? You're actually maybe not even going to go to the water. While I try and navigate through this thick vegetation that this leopard is heading into now, I think head on to James and the Mara, and I think he's also following a big cat.
The lion has got up, everyone. He made a big roaring noise, of course, and then we thought, well, he's obviously not going to try and kill a buffalo if he's shouting at them. And he's managed to get up, and he's now walking towards the others. So let's see what happens here. We might see all three brothers together, which will be very exciting. And he seems to be marking his territory there. I'll just switch off here a second. He's walking straight towards them. He's just going over this little dry drainage line area. I think we're still alive. I seem to have lost the final control. DeAndre, you still got them?
Nope.
We may or may not be live. Oh, we still have us. That's excellent. Good stuff. Oops. Oh, just dropped my Skype call. This area is a disaster for signal. And rate the quality of the call it wants to know. 1 out of 5 it's going to get for that one. Alright, so we're just going to see what he does. If he goes flat with the others, we might consider going towards the herd of buffalo, because behind that herd of buffalo, apparently today, the rest of the lions were. So that would be interesting. And there was a rumour of another male with them, a young male apparently. But that is just hearsay. Move a little bit closer. Turn the lights on a bit, otherwise I can't see anything, and we'll drive into the riverbed and I will be in immeasurable amounts of trouble. see what we can get here. Try and figure out why. Right, I'm not sure. We're trying to get hold of the final control. We've lost them for now. That's okay. We'll figure it out as we go along. We'll just let him get a little bit used to us, and then we'll move up next to him and see if we can't get all three of them in one shot. Right, let me just do this quickly. We're just going to keep watching everybody.
Sorry about that, everybody. James's communication disappeared. Dave and I have just had one of the most intense experiences, certainly the most intense experience of my life, Dave.
Yes.
That was unbelievable. This is absolutely the most bizarre feeling in the world. The lions, all of them, the males, the females, the cubs, started to roar. We can't see a thing. I don't even know exactly where they are. I can't tell you how incredible that was. I'm actually shaking. I always used to, when we had lions roaring, I'd switch off all my vehicle lights with guests. But that was different because you got your piece of skin. You got to take that all the way with you, little one, as you go on a journey. It's going to be hard work. I've never experienced anything like that in my life. As I said, I used to switch off all the time with lions roaring next to us, but we had lights on at one point and we were able to use lights at that time. That was this earth-shattering sound all around us, everywhere around us. On Central Road and Yala Road, the males calling. That was so cool. And at the same time, slightly terrifying. And just like that, I have absolutely no idea where the lions are. Really, seriously, that was incredible. Holy moly. I had my spotlight in my hand just in case I needed to see where I was and what I needed to do. I don't know where the lions are. It's probably time for us to move. I think they have moved off, so we'll be able to reposition. And while we do that, let's go across to Taylor for an update.
Everybody, I'm doing some interesting driving over here, but don't worry, a lot of these trees that I'm going over are dead. Can you see him? Oh, Eggsy's pointing him out to me. We just need to try and find a way through here. We've got lots of aerials and cameras and things that we need to watch out for. Eggsy, are you looking out for that aerial? I've lost him, everybody. Where did he go? There he is. I found him again. He's just in the distance. So I want to see if I can edge on closer to him, but through the easiest way. Now, he's decided that he's not going to give himself up so easily tonight. He's going to make us work for it, which is fine, but it is getting awfully thick, I'm afraid. I'm still waiting for Aubrey to come and help us. I think we're going to have to try a different route. And I'm fine there. Sorry, everybody. I'm going to be quiet for a few moments just while I try and move around here. Trying to find where this male leopard has now disappeared. Where did you go? I've completely lost him now. Ooh. No, that's not him. That's Aubrey making his way into the sighting. I have no idea where this leopard has gone, everybody. It is very thick, as you can see. Let me shine the lights for you. Just have a look how dense it is. It doesn't look actually look too bad, but there's lots of trees and things that are quite high that I can't go over. So I'm going to see if I can't send Aubrey in to try and have a look, and so we can find a spot that we can go through. His vehicle is a lot sort of lower than ours. Right, let's try and get out of here and find another way around, because this way is impenetrable. So he's obviously doing his rounds, and I think he's not interested in the ladies at the moment. I think he's just advertising to everybody that this is his territory. I'm gonna have to chat to Aubrey as well, just to let him know that I don't know where he is. I don't know, maybe we can go through here. We can only try. Please excuse me while I maneuver around, everyone. I apologize for not chatting away to you. I'm trying my best at multitasking. Sorry, I almost had a stick jump out and bite me on the head. Okay, we went down here. Let's try and meander through this thicket, past this big marula tree. Hopefully Aubrey knows his roots a bit better, and he'll be able to gauge where he's gone. Let's sneak through here. My multitasking skills are improving though. We're also making sure we don't drive over any thorn branches. Otherwise, getting a puncture out here at this time of the night is going to be extremely interesting. And this leopard was moving at quite a speed. So I have absolutely no idea where he's gone now. But we will keep scanning away, and hopefully we pick up on either his eye shine. He's given us a slip. He's gone more west of us, everybody. I don't know if you heard that in the distance. Let's quickly head around. That just shows you, even though we've got spotlights and cameras and all sorts of things on him, we can't get him. Right, let me send you over to James, I think. I'm going to have to do some very nice bundu bashing, as we call it.
Now, we've left the lions, everyone. They're fast asleep, but they can sense something's up, possibly just the fact that we've come after them, and we're now sitting here in the pitch-black darkness, shining a very dim red glow on them. And this is one of the great joys of what we're doing out here, of course, is that we can view animals we don't normally see in the night, during the night. And that means we can assess what their behavior is at this time of the day, because normally we wouldn't be looking at them. I suspect on a warm night like this, these buffalo will probably feed a bit, and then as it gets towards the late night, they'll probably lie down and chew the cud. They would have heard those lions. We're not far from them now, probably only about, about a kilometer or so, no less, probably about 400 meters, a quarter of a mile from where the lions are. But they were roaring, and so whether they'll try and hunt the buffalo or not, I don't know. I'm pretty sure they know the buffalo are here. They would have heard them grunting and groaning as they've walked along. But we'll wait and see what happens. What we were rather hoping to do is head down the road here and see if we couldn't find the rest of this pride, the Kichwa pride, and introduce ourselves to the other five lionesses. Jondra, I think you're going to have to kill that light because of the quite astonishing number of insecta there. Jose, I don't know. I think that's quite an interesting question you're asking there. I think, if I heard your question correctly, you're trying to find out if the animals are able to see in infrared at all, and perhaps they can see, perhaps we're assisting them with their view of the world. I think it's possible. I don't know that I think some animals see in a form of infrared. Infrared, of course, is a lower wavelength than we're able to see. And I think some animals could certainly see it, especially those perhaps that have to see at night. But I don't think it'll look anything like the picture you're looking at now, which is quite astonishing given how pitch black dark it is outside. The moon apparently will come up at around 9 o'clock local time, that's 8 o'clock Central African time. So that'll be quite interesting to see. I'm not sure, looking above me here, there are some stars, a smattering, but it's quite a cloudy night. So we'll sit with these beefies for a little while, and then we'll make our way down the road and see if we can't find those other lionesses, because it would be just very special to see the whole pride and introduce ourselves to them so that they all know what you look like and what you sound like, and me too. And they know what Gendre's socks smell like. Now, I think I may have made a mistake. I told Gendre to turn off the presenter light because it was attracting insects. But now, of course, the monitors inside the screen are attracting every fly this side. Oh, listen. Listen. See the buffalo, not particularly worried about it, but they're definitely aware of exactly where that sound's coming from. So they all turn to face, obviously decided they're not close enough to be of too much worry, and they've got on with it. They may well lie down here. They haven't moved very far since we first spotted them with the fleur. Maybe, Gendre, shall we try another fleur shot? I would hold it up for you. There is my head, everybody. Look at what they look like. Isn't that amazing? That is so cool. You see there, Gendre, one of them has just relieved itself. And its dung is still warm. That's an astonishing thing to behold. It's quite a good way of tracking, I suppose. You can tell how fresh some dung is. Now that buffalo looking at us, I think, is looking at the sound of my voice. There I am, everybody. I don't think it's... Oh, it probably could smell us too, obviously. But I don't think it's looking at us. It's so cool. Chewing the cud. Herds of buffalo here compared with the Sabi Sand, I thought have been quite similar, you know. We don't see many of them in the Sabi Sand, but when we do, they're sort of 150 to 200 strong, and that's been roughly the same as here. Yeah, smelling now. You just see the nose lifting. Gendre, what about the other side of the car? I think there's one there. I heard some.
Which side, sorry, James?
Sorry, to the left. Let's just see how far the extent of this herd goes. There we are. There they are. A good size herd this year. I'd say about 250 belching animals, and they're staring at us now. Not particularly sure of what they're looking at. They can smell diesel. Like I say, Gendre's socks. One of the members of the back of the vehicle making a slight belch there, and I'm sure they can sense that, wondering what it is. Maybe they think there's a buffalo in the back of this car. But not affected. They're quite interested. You can see carrying on with the business of chewing the cud. Not in the least bit worried, which is exactly what we want out here. Cool. So if you have just joined us, everyone, we have extended the drive, of course, for an extra four and a half hours. Quite a nice extension to our normal drive.
And that is, of course, to explore the night creatures that are going on in the Sabi Sands in South Africa and, of course, here in the Mara Triangle. And what we're hoping for over the course of the next 5 nights is to be able to follow the lions on the hunt. And it's a unique opportunity here because you can basically drive an immense area. And we also know, of course, that it's clear, it's open. It's not the woodland of the Sabi Sand, and while the Nkuhumas have killed 3 times, I believe, in the last few nights, and you may well get an Nkuhuma kill while we're watching these shows, we're hoping that we're going to get a Kenyan kill over here in the Mara Triangle. It will be very special indeed. Especially if the wildebeest come back. We've had rain for the last 3 nights. We think they could well come wandering back here. That one's just having a sniff at the air. Wet nose, obviously in fine health. Hello, Janet. I think I heard your question correctly. Unfortunately, someone in the final control seemed to be headbutting the wall while the question was being asked. I think your question was, do I think that animals sense differently at night from during the day? Well, oh, here we go. Oh, am I not a bit afraid of being next to the animals in the dark because they may scent us differently in the darkness? No, I'm no more afraid because I think they're very used to us. It's an interesting one, though. You know, if we were in a completely open vehicle next to lions we didn't know at all, would I be a little bit nervous? Maybe for a little while, but we know those lions in the Sabi Sand, we can sit next to them all night long, and we have done often with the lights off. They don't treat us any differently from the way they treat us now. And so, no, I'm not nervous at all. Do I think they scent us differently? Yes, probably slightly, but in the same way that you at night, when you wake up in the dead of the night and you perhaps need to go and get a snack from the kitchen, you use your ears and your sense of touch and your sense of smell to get you to the kitchen rather than your eyes. And I think it's the same very much for these animals here. Oh, Taylor's got a very interesting little primate to show you.
I don't know if you're going to be able to get a good view of this, everybody. We're just trying to find it. Go down a little bit, Eggsy. Down. There we are. Now, you can see a little tail, and we have actually got a bush baby in the tree. We were racing around to try and find a Tingana who was moving through some thick vegetation, but we'll hopefully try and follow up on him. There we go. Look at this bush baby. Look at the little... Oh, have a look at the fingers. Look at the hands if it does sit still again. That's going to be amazing, but unfortunately, they do jump quite a bit. And let's see if we can maybe get one more glimpse of it. Maybe it's come out into the open for us. It's a nice warm evening. Oh no, unfortunately I can't find it anymore. Where did you go? Oh, there, I see movement on the trees. My goodness, it's hopping away. It's in, over here. There it is. Can you see it? Have a look. Oh my goodness, you are so lucky, everybody, to be seeing this little bush baby. So if you can zoom in a little bit more, I want you to have a look at its feet and its hands. It's quite difficult. It's obviously quite dark. Maybe should we try infrared while it's sitting here? Let's have a look. Can you see it there? It's quite difficult. You can just see the glow of its eyes now. But I wonder what I wanted to tell you about this Galago, this bush baby. Sorry, everybody, I got so excited. Was that they've got incredible little hands. I don't know if you saw very quickly a glimpse of how fat their fingers are. Now, we can't go in too much with it. Oh, there's another one. What on earth is going on this evening? We have been so lucky. Look at the two of them. I'm chopping and jumping. I'm so excited. Did you see how they were grooming each other? And I can hear Tingana in the background as well. I think he may have crossed out of our property, unfortunately. But we'll spend some time with these bush babies. So these look like two adults. Possibly it's a male and a female. Now, both of them are territorial. They both actually mark and defend territories, and very much like a leopard, you'll have many females that have got much smaller territories, and then you'll have a male who comes through and sees all these lovely females. So that is quite amazing. Normally you just see them on their own, but unfortunately they have leapt out of our view now. But that was quite spectacular. As I drive, we're gonna try our luck and see if Tingana is still around. I wanted to tell you now about their hands, and I don't know if you managed to see the very broad fingers that they had, and those are amazing how they've adapted for obviously climbing as well as for grabbing insects. They'll grab insects while they're leaping in the air. They'll grab a flying insect, or they will grab something on the ground too. That was very special, everybody. A very short glimpse, but how amazing to see two unusual creatures. Let's head back to James and see how he's faring in the Mara.
Jamie here, not James, I'm afraid to say. But we do have a lion. Might not be a Mara Triangle lion, but there's definitely a lion. We have let the Nkuhumas and their cubs wander off after our incredible experience with them all around the vehicle. And for now we have returned to our Birmingham boy, who is still lying up quite comfortably in the middle of the road and showing no inclination that he's going to go wandering off. Mike is here with some guests, so we're just going to speak quite quietly, and that's the light that you are seeing. Because it is an adult lion, we are able to spotlight him, which is where the extra level of illumination is coming from. It looks really cool though. This whole experience has been utterly incredible. And he goes about cleaning his mane. How's that? This is all very, very cool. Such an amazing experience. I haven't even thought about my lunchbox. That's how amazing an experience it has been. Those scars look even more impressive in this light. There's an intense look for you. Now, James Bear, my goodness, yes, you're asking a question that I was asking myself as well, which was, are the lions reacting any differently to us at night than they are during the day? And the answer is no, and I didn't really expect them to be honest. We know that lions react differently when we're on foot at night as opposed to during the day, but they've never reacted differently to us in vehicles at night. Not in my experience in the bush. They might be a little bit bolder. The cubs, I think, were the biggest difference. The cubs were a lot more relaxed with us at night than they are during the day. They walked right up to the vehicle. They didn't even give us a secondary glance. I think they do just feel a bit more secure at night. So it wasn't that we were feeling as if we were in any more danger. It's just interesting to see how they respond to us without spotlights. And the answer was they didn't respond any differently to any other time that we've sat with them at night with lights. It was just the cubs that were interesting because they were much more relaxed. But as you can see, I mean, this Birmingham boy is just ignoring us. Now, Christine, you wanted to know what the concern is with following the cubs at night. That was a decision that we came to after a couple of after discussions. And my decision was that the additional noise as we follow them at night, and it's very, very difficult to drive without lights, I felt that it was a step too far. I didn't want to interfere with their nightly activities in a way that might compromise them, and I can't see all that well when I'm driving without lights. So I can't drive purely with the infrared. I have to have lights on, and if I didn't, I wouldn't be able to see more than 10 meters in front of my vehicle, and I'm not prepared to take that chance. So that was my reasoning behind why I decided we would not be following cubs at night. Extra noise, extra sound. I can't see as well as I can see during the day or with my lights on. I'm trying to move out of your way. Oh, this is so cool. Oh. Cool. Okie dokie then. Well, that was an inconvenient place, mister. Oh, this is so weird. I'm staring into the darkness. I know there's a lion there, but I can't see him. I can only see him on my monitor. Amazing. All right, let's head across to Taylor and see what she's up to.
Look at this massive beetle that I've managed to find. I almost actually squashed him, and then luckily I saw him scurrying along the road. So this is called a two-spot beetle. It's in the largest order of insects, which is the Coleoptera family, and that is obviously the family of beetles. Now, this beetle has obviously come out onto the road to try and hunt some other insects. I'm actually being plagued by moths at the moment because of all the lights. And what I'd really like to try and do is I'd like to see what this looks like with the infrared. I don't know how well it's going to work, but let me switch off everything else. Let's see how it goes. No, nothing. There it is, it's still there. We're trying to switch to IR, everybody, but it didn't seem to work. So we will just look at him normally. There we go. Okay, there we go. Look at him. This is amazing, this infrared. Now, I know certain insects can see color, but I'm not sure if they can see this infrared light. It'll be quite interesting to find out. I'll have to do a bit of research when I get back home late this evening to find out if insects can actually see infrared light. He's scurrying along looking for something to eat this evening, and it's really nice because the temperature is quite warm. There's no wind, so I suspect that we're going to be seeing quite a few insects this evening. Now, I'm actually going to send you on to James this time, everybody, and not to Jamie. Sorry, I didn't hear Rebecca in final control this evening. My brain is still so excited about everything that we just saw in the last few moments. Well, I hope James is having lots.
See what else we can find along this road. Like I said, there, as you can see, perhaps in that. Well, look, it's not the best picture you've ever seen, but we have something quite interesting there, and we're going to go and drive off road and see if we can't find what it is. Are you ready? That's Jandre pointing out what it is we were looking at. Right, on we go. Now, Graham, we're going to try and get off road here. This might result in us being stuck for 7 days, but we'll try it anyway. Are we still going towards it, Graham? Isn't it difficult to tell? We're going straight towards it now, everybody. Now, it could be something as exciting as an aardwolf, a striped hyena, a spotted hyena. It could also be a hot rock, perhaps even a very large piece of warm dung. It will be fascinating to know when we get there. Can you see it? Simon says he can see eyes. That's encouraging. Hello, everyone. Excuse my not looking at you. I do not wish to singe my eyeballs with the IR. IR is off. Hi, everybody. What can you see there, Simon? We're getting closer. Oh, I can see eyes. Oh. We've seen one of those before, haven't we, Jean-André? There you are, everybody. It's your first Mara Impala. Yes. Well done, everybody. Again. Let's go back to the road and we'll carry on this adventure. This is an excellent way to spot things at night. I'm thoroughly impressed with the thermal camera. Thoroughly impressed with the infrared. I'm thoroughly impressed, frankly, with being in Kenya. I haven't seen Merrill or Robert just yet. Right, now, we've got very special permission to be off-road. There isn't a lot of off-road driving here, and that's because it's much the same as in the Kruger National Park. In the Kruger National Park, of course, it is a national park. And if you had everybody driving off-road willy-nilly, well, there'd probably be quite a lot of environmental damage. Do you think this is not a good sign? You think we must go to the right? Ow, I've just broken my elbow on one of the sharp points that the Land Rover designers have very kindly put in here. We'll try and get back onto the road. What do you think, Simon? You think we'll make it? You think we'll get stuck for 7 weeks? Simon is in agreement that we'll be stuck for 7 weeks. There we go. So what we're going to do is continue driving along this road, see if we can't find the other five lionesses. Perhaps they are in the process of hunting, and we might be very lucky. Oh, there goes my water bottle. There's the top of my head. Thank you, Jean-André. Very flattering angle. So, we don't have a roofless car, everybody, for the same reason that most people don't have open cars because, of course, this is a national park and you can drive your own car. Jamie apparently has some lions. That is going to be much better than watching me contort myself to look at you. Let's go and have a look at them.
I don't think it'll be any better than James, but it is magnificent. And our male lion is very much on the move. Now, it's going to be impossible for me to follow him down into this drainage line itself, so I'm going to have to go around. I'm hoping he's going to give us one more big roar. Oh, I can do this, actually. There we go. He's been marking his territory pretty much consistently since he stood up a little while ago. And off he goes. He's going to go and investigate where that kill site was. That's exactly where he's heading. And that is our cue to start going round. I'm hoping I can meet him on Central Road. I'm hoping that's the direction he decides to take. But we'll trundle slowly along and see what we can find. This is such a fun experience. Okay. I'm not going to try and follow him down there. I'm just going to wreck the vehicle. Bye-bye. Please come back onto a road. I wonder if I should just stay in low range the whole time. This is all a learning experience for us. Definitely a learning experience for me. Right, I'm going to be using the spotlight to spot things. And then if it's something cool to look at that we can look at in total infrared, then I'll drop the spotlight and all our lights, and we can go dark. So the lionesses and the cubs have walked west. They've gone into the block towards Central Road. Taylor might bump into them at some point as she trundles along. We're going to go and see what else the night has in store for us for the next however long we're out for. I'm in no rush for this incredible safari experience to end. I'm hoping we're going to catch up with the Birmingham boys slightly separately to the rest of the pride. Maybe we might even find the young Nkuhuma lioness and her companion that I assume she must have. Oh, and soon we're going to be seeing chameleons and all kinds of amazing things. And who knows, perhaps you'll be on the back with me when we get to see, when I get to see, my very first aardvark of my life. The opportunities and the possibilities are positively boundless. Right, our male lion's going to pop out in there. We're going to try and go around him and predict where it is he's going to go. He might decide to follow the rest of the pride, which does leave us a little bit stuck because, as I said, we're not going to be following them. But we'll figure this out as we go along. And there's always bush babies aplenty. Look at this! Look around. Now, Jason, you wanted to know how dangerous it is to be sitting next to lions with no lights or following them. Following them, I would, as I said, only be following the adult lions, so I would be using my spotlight as well and my lights so that I can see a little bit in front of me. It's not dangerous. They don't see us as prey when we're in the vehicle at night. They didn't even so much as glance at us in a weird way. It's not dangerous. Rationally, I know that completely 100% to be true. Irrationally, it's something both Dave and myself experienced. I'm not going to pretend otherwise. I'm not going to lie to you. I've never been like that way. And I've never been particularly inclined towards the macho bent that you might encounter every now and again in the bush. I've never been particularly that way inclined. So I'm not going to lie to you. I was never afraid, but it was a really intimidating feeling. It was a truly surreal feeling. It was a feeling of... Hello. And Gracie, as we watch our little scrub hare hop away, he's not very scary, is he, Dave? No. Gracie, who is 9 years old, said she would be a bit scared in the dark, and was I scared at all? Gracie, kind of. Not very. I wasn't very, very scared. I wasn't fearful, but I was anxious. I'm not going to lie to you at all. I could feel my heart getting faster, and it felt like my whole body was ready to do something, to burst into action if it needed to. And it is like my body knows that it's deprived of its primary sense out here, and it just felt very, very strange. Okay, let's head back into Taylor's vehicle, see what she's found for you in the night.
I am finding all the creepy crawlies of the night, and we're looking at a cricket, everybody. I'm not sure what type of cricket we're looking at, but it is some form of a cricket. And they're interesting little creatures. I haven't been seeing too many of them. You often hear them in your rooms at night. And I know that as a guide, they tend to plague us because you'll go to sleep, you'll turn the lights off, much like the mosquitoes, and they chirp away. And then when you try to find them, to try and take them outside and release them safely, they go quiet. Can you believe that? He's on the move. Is he proving difficult to keep up with? He's the fastest cricket in the world, everybody. Now, crickets are omnivores, so they eat other insects. They'll eat leaves. He's going to disappear out of range, and he's going to go underneath my vehicle, I'm afraid. And they are omnivores, and they eat a variety of different things. So from the vegetation, so to the leaves and fruit, as well as to other little insects. Now, I'm a bit worried that I'm going to squish him, seeing as that some places around the world believe that crickets actually bring you good luck. Now, I would hate to squash an insect that brings you good luck. So maybe we'll have to wait for him to come out on the other side of my vehicle, and then we'll be able to reposition quite safe, well, him being safe. And isn't it amazing how we've only just been out for an extra hour or so, and the different things that we have found already have just been phenomenal. I'm quite enjoying finding all these strange little insects and those bush babies, those lesser galagos, some of you may know them as. It was quite amazing to see that interaction between, I'm pretty sure it was a male and a female, was unbelievable how they groomed each other and then they carried on and bounced away. Now I have a question for all of you that are are watching the show. I tried to do some research on it today and I couldn't find the answer. So perhaps all of you that are watching us this evening could possibly help me. So I'd like to know, how far can a lesser gala go or a lesser bush baby leap? I was trying to find the answer. So if you manage to get that answer for me, please let me know. You can either hashtag Safari Life or you can also send us an email at questions@wildearth.tv. And I'll be adding that answer to my notebook, everybody. So just once again, if you can try and find out for me, how far can a lesser bush baby or a lesser gala go leap? That'd be incredible. Let me just double check over the side of the edge if our friend the cricket has gone. Eggsy, can you see anything? No? That makes me nervous. Maybe I must go straight back. I think let's do that. Let's go straight back and hopefully we don't squash him. No, we need to try and maneuver. Please, Cricky, please don't get squashed. Just checking to see if I can see it. I cannot see it. So I think we would have been okay. I didn't hear a crunch. So that makes me feel a bit better. So I'm going to keep driving with my lights on, everybody, just because it's a bit easier. I cannot see anything with the infrared. Oh, I've come unplugged. I'm unplugged, everybody. I apologize. That's probably why I didn't hear any chatting. I'm back in again. I can breathe again. My lifeline. While I carry on trying to look for some more creatures of the night, let's go to James.
Look at that. There are some zebras. That is the IR light, and you may have just seen a little red square flash away from the left-hand side. There we go. It seems to be when this thing thinks it's spotted something else. Then it puts a little red square around it, which is very National Geographic of it, rather than really, isn't it? It's amazing. Look at that. Now these zebras are grazing completely contentedly next to us, probably, about 30 meters or so. And you can see that they are most certainly mammals. They're very hot. 37 or 8 degrees or so. That's so cool. Isn't that amazing? Now, just to explain a little bit about this, of course, it's a thermal imaging camera, which means it's picking up different kinds of temperatures or different temperature variations and then sort of converting them to the picture that you see there. And the reason that it isn't in the sort of glorious high definition that we normally get is apparently you need to be part of the military to have a very particular fancy one, because I think they're used for nefarious purposes. But this one is good enough for us to see that zebra way behind there on the right hand side. She's pregnant, and there are lots of pregnant zebra around here at the moment. Look how fat her belly is. The one that just had a flash over her. Let's go back to the IR genre and see if we can't get a bit, slightly better view of them. There they are over there. That's it. And we're a little bit far from for the IR to work particularly well, but there you can see them grazing contentedly, completely free of us. Now look how many there are. When I got here, well, for the first time 2 weeks ago, and then again now, 4 days ago. Just astounding the number. This must be a herd of some, 100 or 200 zebras. In the background, a hyena is calling. There is a hyena den somewhere around here, but we've yet to be able to find it. Masses and masses of hyena research has been completed in this part of the world. And that's because I think it's just quite easy to sort of drive around here and find them, and you've got this great expanse of land with clans of hyenas, apparently up to 50 strong in some cases. That's so wonderful. Look, she's definitely pregnant too. Look how fat her belly is. Now they move, of course, with the wildebeest, the zebra do, and there are something like 300,000 of them that follow the 1.4 odd million wildebeest that move here. 300,000 zebra. Now, that might sound like a lot, of course, but at the end of the day, if you compare it with a human population, it's less than a small city would have. This is the Grant's gazelle, as I said. Not gazelle. It's not a gazelle at all, is it, Jean-André? No, it is an equid. Jean-André's not talking to me anymore. That's very sad. I wonder what I've done. It's a Grant's zebra. So, same as the plain zebra we get back at Juma. Just a slightly different subspecies, and I think that the most distinctive look on the zebra is, listen, there's a jackal calling. Side-striped jackal. It's a very amazing call. I've never heard them do that. I wouldn't have known what it was if Simon hadn't told me. And obviously no threat to the Roman-nosed Grant's zebra. What I've been trying to tell you. I've tried to tell it to you twice now. There they are. Just a slightly rounded nose there. And no shadow stripe at all. They're just as bad-tempered, though, as the zebras back home. Lots and lots of pregnant females. And look, I mean, they're supposed to have exactly the same sort of structure, a social structure, and it's very clear to see when you go to Juma, and you've got a very clear stallion, his wives, one or two offspring, and that's how they move along in what we call a kinship group. This, much more difficult to tell, of course, because they move as a great big group of 200 or 300 quite often. Hello, Monique. You're in London and you're wondering about the hyenas that we get here and whether we get different kinds of hyenas. There are different kinds of hyena here, Monique. The striped hyena would be a really impressive one to see. It's slightly smaller than the spotted and is ostensibly, I think it is a scavenger of sorts, but it doesn't, it's certainly nothing like as dominant or anything like the size of a spotted hyena. Then the most exciting one that you can find here is something called an aardwolf. Now, in theory, you can find them in South Africa. They're not common, but apparently they're a bit more common around here. An aardwolf is like a tiny little hyena, and they eat termites and ants. That's what they survive on, almost exclusively on termites and ants. And I'll try and show you a picture, but I don't think it's possible with the infrared. Very nice. Ooh, that's an injury. Now, we did see one zebra today who had a nasty gash on his bottom, very clearly from a lion's claw that slashed at him. But that one seems to be fine. I thought there might be an injury on the neck there. And you can see them grazing, grazing, grazing away. There's so much for them to eat here. And apparently, La Niña has got a slightly different effect, or a completely opposite effect here. So La Niña will make the air dry here, where it is wet and down in South Africa, and El Niño will make it wet here and dry in South Africa. So the grass here is extremely long, and apparently they've had the best wilderness migration they've had in years this year. Now, I don't know when it was appropriate for me to tell you this, but today, of course, for many of you, you will know, is International Talk Like a Pirate Day. I am not joking in the slightest. It is indeed International Talk Like a Pirate Day, and so I'm going to ask that Rebecca tells Jamie and Taylor to greet you like a pirate the next time you go and see her. As far as I'm concerned, well, I will greet you in my best pirate the next time I see you. We're going to move along down the road, and while we're doing that, let's head across to Captain Jimmy on the good ship Rustbucket.
No. Yarr, my apologies. I turned me mic off by mistake. Yarr, me and me first mate, Darby here, would like to show you an art wolf. Aye, matey. It's a very purty looking animal. Thank you, James, for throwing us under the bus. Pity my mic was off, so you missed the giggles that happened initially. That is an odd wolf, everybody. It is a beautiful animal, and we shall continue the pirate-themed talking as we go on. But for now, that is an odd wolf, often argued to be in the hyena order, not order, sorry, family. But there's much debate about that, because of course it is an insectivore. Does not have the strong bone-crushing jaws of our hyenas, our spotted or our brown, and it is an animal that I've been fortunate enough to see many, many times when I used to work in the Kalahari, and it is an incredible creature to see, fascinating looking. And then we're in my old job just before I came here, we knew of an aardvark den that we used to go and watch little aardwolf. I've got aardvarks on the brain. Aardwolf den. We used to go and watch little baby aardwolves wander about. They are absolutely amazing an animal. Now, hello to any new viewers that might be joining us for the first time as I put my aardwolf away. I would greet you in a pirate voice, but I feel as though perhaps a decent impression needs to be made first. Otherwise, you might think we're slightly mad. As you come to be addicted to Safari Live, you will know that we are slightly mad. My name is Jamie, and this evening I have the wonderful, dazzling Downpour Dave on camera with me. There's a history behind his nickname, but you'll have to just stay tuned to future Safari Live drives in order to find out the history. We are coming to you live in the middle of the night from a place called Juma Private Game Reserve. Taylor and myself are driving around to seek out all of the nocturnal mysteries of the night in the African bush to show you, and James presenting to you live from the Mara Triangle. Can you believe it? All in all, you are in for a fascinating experience, and I'd like to welcome you on board. We're right up in the top northeastern corner of South Africa, by the way. So not only is this whole experience live, it is also interactive, which means that you can send through your questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, and you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv as we head out and start filming in a combination of normal camera and infrared light, depending upon what we see. Isn't that exciting? I was going to continue on my explanation, however, what should we call Taylor? I can't think of any more piratey terms. This is ridiculous. I can't call her that. That would be true. I can't call her that on live. We're going to go over to Taylor now, and I'll think of better pirate speak as we go along.
Arg, me hearties. Now, that is the end of my pirate talking. I've been trying to practice on what else I would say and how I would say scrub hair with a pirate accent, and it sounded horrendous, so I thought I'd spare myself the embarrassment and just admit that I'm not very good at talking like a pirate. But here we have a pair of scrub hairs. Now, you can't see the other one because it is just out of screen and it's a bit too far away just to reach with the infrared. But we've got this one on the right munching away, which is quite amazing. Now, we don't tend to spot scrub hares with their light. They're also quite frightened on them. So I'm really excited to watch what these hares get up to with the infrared light. And they don't seem too bothered by us at all. They actually are more relaxed than what they normally are. You see them munching along on some grass. Here we go. You're going to bite it off? Nope. And I'm still waiting for the answer, everybody, as to how far a lesser bush baby can jump. Has anybody managed to get that answer for me? I've got my notebook and pen in hand awaiting your answers while we watch these scrub hares run around. Also, listening very carefully, you can see how the ears are moving on either side. Wow, everybody. Daryl, Mick, and Tarjinder, thank you so much for your speedy responses. So they have sort of commented that a bush baby can leap up to 2 meters. That is a huge jump, everybody. That's quite impressive, and that explains why they disappeared so quickly from one branch to the next tree.
So thank you so much, everybody, for those answers. I've added that to my notebook. And a lot of people get confused, I've noticed, being out on safaris. The first glimpse, everybody always shouts, rabbit! But now in this area, we actually don't have any rabbits. We've just got the scrub hares, and there's quite a significant difference between the rabbits and the scrub hares. So firstly, if you have a look at those pointy ears, you see how they are pointed up towards the sky? That's very typical of a hare. Rabbit's ears tend to flop slightly. And also, as it's been moving around, did you notice how it wasn't it wasn't hopping, it was actually walking and running, so they can run at great speeds. And another difference between hares and rabbits is that a hare doesn't burrow. So those of you who have ever seen rabbits or had them as pets possibly, you know that they love to burrow. Now hares don't do that. They sort of rest underneath a shrub or underneath a tree, use the leaves and branches as a bit of shelter. There's the other one popping up now in the background. And they'll even have their babies also out in the open and under a shrub, so they don't burrow underground at all. And this is amazing to see, everybody. I can't tell you how they always race away from us when we put the spotlight on them. So it's so great to see them, that they are completely relaxed with the infrared. Now, James has got my second favorite animal ever. Go and have a look.
Now, everyone, there they are, three hyenas, three Mara hyenas from one of the big clans in this area. We're not too far from the Mara River at the moment, and we're heading off-road to have a look at them. That's a youngster there, and I so miss my hyenas. And we'll just try and follow them. Lovely and open here, so that should be quite easy for us. Shouldn't be too much bouncing. Andre, I'm afraid you're going to have to stay zoomed in on them because I cannot see where they've gone.
It's 11.
11 o'clock?
Yeah. 11 again?
Andre, of course, is in two minds, everyone, because if he does zoom all the way in, the picture will shake horribly. All right, let's just keep going. We'll put on a bit of wine
again.
Ah, there they are. Sloping through the night. Now, maybe they'll take us towards their den. Hello, Rain. You're 16 years old, and you say that a bunch of you and your mates are watching this at school on your lunch break. That is awesome. It's really, really good to hear from you. And I'm so glad you're enjoying it. I'm just going to assume that you're in the States. If you're having your lunch break now and you're watching this at school, that's so great. Thanks very much. Tell us what your mates are called. Called, ask us a question. We'll be more than happy to talk to you. Thank you very much for giving us of your time during your lunch break to watch us. That's fantastic news. Exactly why we do this, everyone. Now, who knows what these hyenas are going to do? Maybe they'll go back towards a den site.
11, John.
There is apparently a den site somewhere around this area. Is that another road there? Now, of course, I'm exploring many of these areas for the first time, the same way that you are, everyone. Hello, Jason, you're wondering about their calls and whether they act differently in the nighttime. Well, I mean, I've never seen a Mara hyena. Well, I have once, but they seem to behave in much the same way that ours do. But in many parts of East Africa, you know, they hunt even more than the lions do, and probably especially down when they're calving. Around here, however, there's so much to scavenge that I suspect they're largely scavenging. Now, we're driving on. They're walking on a path. I don't know if you're able to make that out. But they're basically driving on a well-worn path, and I wonder if this doesn't lead to their den site. If it doesn't, it will probably be some kind of an elephant path. So let's keep following them. This is just fantastic. Now, we don't often follow hyena off-road at Juma, and that is largely because they don't tolerate the vehicles being mobile and crashing through the bushes behind them, as many of the other cats do. But these chaps, because we're able to drive through some open areas, perhaps they're just going to let us keep following them. Also, so many people have done a huge amount of research on the hyenas of this area that it might be that they'll just put up with us. Look at them going there. Every time I see a little termite mound, I think maybe. This is fantastic. This is exactly why we wanted to come out here. Well, essentially we want to see lions hunt, but this is pretty good. We'll go back to those lions just now. We'll let them digest a bit of their food.